Dit was mijn bureau.
This was my desk. Beb sat opposite me at a similar desk. Mr. Kleiman sat here alongside. We three formed a close-knit group. To the rear was another office belonging to Mr. Kuchler. He would come by every now and then. During office hours, we didn't discuss our refugees much. Everything had to proceed as normal. Talking about them created a certain tension. It caused you to worry about them in the office, and that wouldn't do. It was vital that we appeared to the outside world, to people who came here, to be as nonchalant as possible. Mr. Frank had said, meet, find a greengrocer that's close by. So I used to go to a shop on the Lelykroeg. But in May of 1943, when I entered the shop lady told me that her husband had been seized. They had been hiding two Jews themselves. Mr. Frank insisted then that I not go there for the time being because it was too dangerous. I came away from the canal and went in the opposite direction towards the Rosengrock. Here I found a small cellar. Yeah, it looked quite different in those days. It was a plain cellar where the vegetables would be lying on the ground or on pallets. Also, vegetables were scarce then. That's a striking difference. I came in and encountered an old woman who was somewhat disheveled. She was whining and moaning to herself. I listened to her, and what was she talking about but her kids? Her kids who had discarded her and who only came around when they needed money or vegetables or whatever. She prattled on like that, and I agreed with her at every turn. Meanwhile, I had an eye out for what I could get. That was quite important. Surprisingly, without any trouble whatsoever, she served me. You'd come up, and there was a level of tension as you entered the room. They waited anxiously for you in a row. They waited for whatever you might say. That made me feel dreadful. Only Anne would greet me and say, "Hello, Miep. Got any news?" Her mother always hated that. Anne was often criticized for her behavior. The children, the Franks' children, were raised in far too liberal an atmosphere. I knew that when I left, Mrs. Frank and Mrs. Van Pels would quarrel over it. But Anne couldn't help herself. It was just her way. She was spontaneous and said what was on her mind. That the others just waited until I spoke, I found truly dreadful, because I could feel their utter dependency on us, their helpers. The meekness with which they greeted me each morning was terrible. They would give me a list of what they needed, a shopping list and so forth. When that business was done, one of them would scamper up to me, Mrs. Van Pels, for example, and say, Meep, I need this or that too. I just wrote it down and tried to get it.
Meep told us that they were rousting Jews from their homes again. Countless friends and acquaintances have gone to a terrible end. Any revelation from Meep concerning the fate of an acquaintance makes Mother or Mrs. Van Pels cry. So Meep now thinks it's best not to say anything at all.
Those were terrible events, and I related them all honestly. I recounted whatever happened in town. After a while, my husband Jan said, Meep, please don't tell them everything. You have to remember that these people are incarcerated. They're not free to move. That's depressing enough as it is. At least dilute the truth slightly. Just skim the surface. So I did that. But that didn't get past Anne. She sensed there was more to be told. When I'd said what I had to say and I was poised to go, she would take me aside for a chat. She'd say, Meep, tell me about this and that. She'd question me so extensively that I couldn't avoid it any longer, and I told her everything. That was Anne.
If it is this bad in Holland, what is it like in the distant reaches where they go? We assume that most of them are murdered. The English radio speaks of their being gassed. Perhaps that's the quickest way to die.
The persistent reports that some of these camps in Germany are in fact extermination camps with specially constructed gas.
The English radio has always told the truth. The fact is that in Poland and Russia, millions of peace-loving people are simply murdered or gassed.
Those events were discussed in the annex, what was known of them, what they'd heard. But speaking for myself, I could not believe that people would do such atrocious things. I simply could not believe it. I had no idea that Anne would write it all down. What do you imagine when you see a child with a diary? You wouldn't think she'd write such things. Dr. Pfeffer was my dentist and a close acquaintance of the Franks. Pfeffer asked me incessantly if I could hide him. I said no. I went to Mr. Frank and told him that Pfeffer wanted to go into hiding. The next day, Mr. Frank said, Meep, where seven people eat, eight can eat as well. Go tell Pfeffer you have a place for him. Naturally, he needed to sleep somewhere. It was arranged that Pfeffer would sleep here and Anne would settle over there. This was Anne's table, which she now had to share with Pfeffer.
Yesterday, I asked Pfeffer quite politely if I might also use our table. What do you think the very learned Pfeffer replied? No. Just plain no.
Pfeffer wrote letters to his wife here. And he studied Spanish. Therefore, he sat for long periods of time at the table. Meanwhile, Anne was attempting to carry on with her diary.
One moment I thought I'm going to smack him in the face, and then the next, stay calm, he's not worth getting upset about.
This here